'cause you're good on your promise. I'll take you at your
be seated for just one moment. Welcome to VNC, the first Sunday of 2024. And if you haven't heard yet, this is the year of our 100-year celebration here in this community. So we've got some big things in store for us and for this this community this coming year as we're celebrating that 100-year mark. I want to take a moment and just welcome you. Maybe this is one of your first time joining us. We just are so grateful, so thankful that you've chosen to worship here at VNC. We're going to ask that you do just a couple things. First one is right on the screen, there's a QR code. If you would take your phone out, scan that QR code, fill out that information. That helps us to get to know you just a little bit better. And then after the service, right out in the foyer, there's a place called Guest Central. We want to make sure that you stop by there. We want to meet you face-to-face, and we've got just a small gift as a way of saying thank you for worshiping with us today. Also, today is a little bit unique as well. After this service, we've got something called Lunch with Leaders, and that is just an opportunity for those of you that are newer to the church to be able to come and enjoy a nice free lunch, get to know some of the staff and us to get to know you a little bit better, and it's just a kind of an informal time where we get to have lunch and talk and hang out a little bit and for you to get to know a little bit more about our church. So like I said, right after this service, right down in the Youth Center, we'll be hosting that lunch. We would love to have you and your entire family join us for that. Couple things as we start out this new year, we want to make sure that you're aware of some really great opportunities to be able to connect with each other, but more importantly, be able to grow in our relationship with Jesus. The first one is starting next Monday night. We're doing a 21 straight days of prayer. We want to invite you. We're going to be gathering here at the church each night from 6:30 to 7:30. There's going to be a little bit of music. There's going to be a time of prayer, and it's going to be just a great 21 days of us joining together, praying together, growing together as we head into this new year. Now, we know there's a lot of schedules. We know there's a lot of things on your calendar, a lot of other events. We are not expecting you to be at every single one of those 21 days. If you're able to do that, great. If not, we completely understand. If there are certain days you can make it, we would love to have you no matter how many times you're able to be there for those days. But we are looking forward to joining as a church and starting out this new year in prayer. Also starting coming up, we believe one of the greatest resources we have in this community is our facility. And right down this hallway, we have a full-size gym, if you've never seen that. We want to be able to utilize that to reach different parts of our community. On January 17th, next Wednesday, we'll be starting a pickleball opportunity. I know that a lot of you are into that. A lot of you have started to play that. And as we get into the worst months weather-wise in Northwest Indiana in January, February, and March, we want to transform our gym into some pickleball opportunities. We would love for you to be part of that. So if you are interested in being a part of that pickleball league, go online, sign up to be part of it. There are two different opportunities in that. There's one for the beginners, the ones that just want to maybe have fun, that just want to play around a little bit. And then there's another one for those of you that are a little bit more serious, that want to, you know, actually compete and want to, you know, do some damage on the court. So we encourage you to sign up for what you feel is most appropriate. We don't want to just fill your calendar. This is not just another thing to put on there. We believe this would be a great chance to build some community. As you're out there playing, sweating, talking, just to get to know some other people here in this church and maybe inviting some people that you know in your workplaces, in your homes, to be part of that league as well. We believe that's a great opportunity. So we got the 21 days of prayer. We've got the pickleball league starting up. There's some great things happening as we kick off 2024. But we don't want to look too far in advance. Right now and right here, we had a great 9 a.m. service, and we are anticipating that God is going to do some great things in our midst, even right now. And so we want to continue on in worship as we sing, as we spend some time in prayer, as we hear from the Word, that we are gathered here in this place to glorify God, but to let Him speak into us and change us as we are here this morning. So let's go ahead. Let's stand back up. Find someone near you. Welcome them to VNC and tell them that you're glad that they're here. If you're joining us online, thank you for being here. Jump in the chat. Make sure you're connecting with other people and make sure you're checking out some of those opportunities to connect on the website as well. Thanks for being here.
We're going to declare this together as one body in Christ alone. My hope is found.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest trial and storm. What heights of peace when fears are stilled, when striving
Atmosphere. Your glory, God, is what our hearts
Presence and his goodness are here in this place, and we're going to continue to acknowledge that this morning and sing about who he is. Let's lift this up together. You are here.
You are here.
darkness, my God, that is who you are.
I'm gonna declare this promise that he's always working.
Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working. Even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I don't feel it, you're working. You never stop, you never stop working. You never stop, you never stop working.
As we spend these next couple moments in prayer, I think it's a song like that that we can declare some of those truths. That we have a God, we have a creator who is the way maker, that he is the miracle worker, that he is a promise keeper. And so when we spend these next couple moments praying together, that we have a foundation of which we can trust that God is who he says he is. And when we pray, we're not asking him to change according to our standards. We're not asking him to move according to our will, but that in our prayer that our own will would be shaped and moved to his. Because he is the foundation. He is the rock. He is the one that's the constant standard that we go to in prayer. So maybe in these next couple of moments that you want to maybe come to an altar and you want to pray, great. You want to gather with friends and family, that would be awesome. Maybe you want to pray for one of the requests on the wall that people have put up there to say, I need help in prayer. I need someone to pray for me on those things. Maybe you want to spend some time on the other side at the answer prayer. Maybe you just want to read through those, spending every moment praising God that he's on the move, that he's done incredible things, that he was a way maker for those particular requests. Regardless of what we do, these next couple moments, we have an opportunity to cry out to him as a people together, and also for him to be able to speak back into us. So let's pray together. Father, today we come before you and we are humbled that the creator of the universe, the maker of all things, the one who created us on purpose and for a purpose would want to have relationship with us. That while we are individual, we are unique in our identity, but you have created us not just to be solo and by ourselves and off on our own, but you have created us to be a people. You have created us to crave for and to belong in community. And so while we gather in this place and we come before you, we know that there are churches all over this community, all across this nation, all across this world that are gathering today in your name. And they are crying out to you. And they are coming together as a community, as one voice and in one spirit. And you are hearing the prayers of your people. And so today, as we are in this place and we have gathered together, we pray that you would hear our cry. We know that there is a lot of things going on in our lives. And we know that you are on the move. And we can look back over this last year, over these last couple months, weeks, days, or maybe even these last couple hours. And we know that there is junk that is going on, that there is hurt and there is brokenness. And people have experienced pure evil in their lives. But when we come together and we declare that you are who you say you are, and we declare one of the hardest things that we can possibly do, and we say we trust you, we look back on those things and we can see the evidence of where your hand was every step of the way. We can see where your presence interceded. We can see where you were there comforting us and guiding us, giving us encouragement. And so it's on that foundation that when we look back, that we can look ahead knowing no matter what this next year brings ahead of us, that we have confidence in a God who is a way maker, God who is a miracle worker, a God who does keep his promises. And we lean on that. We rest on that. We take comfort in knowing that you are that rock moving forward. God, I pray that in our midst today, that as we have gathered and we are seeking after you, that we have declared through song, we have invited the Holy Spirit to be in this place. And not that these walls and this roof or this building can keep you away, but that our hearts would be ready and willing and to receive you today, that we'd be filled, a new filling of your Spirit, that we would leave this place. We would go back into our schools, we'd go back into our workplaces, back in our community this week, and that we would be able to bring a little bit of heaven to this earth this week. That there would be, that it would be more of in Valparaiso, in Northwest Indiana, as it is in heaven. So I pray today that as you are changing us, as you are molding us, as you are shaping us, as we are becoming even more like you, that we leave this place ready to serve you, ready to show people your love, ready to show people your compassion and your mercy, so that they would be able to experience maybe just a glimpse of heaven on earth. And Father, we know that there are so many things going on in our lives. We don't deny that. We know that people are broken and hurting and lost and kind of seeking. We pray that you continue to walk with them and dwell in the midst of that pain and that hurt, showing them who you are, drawing us even closer to you than we were before, knowing that you've got us. Father, I pray that you continue to work through this service. Pray that you would anoint Pastor Chris's words, that they be your words, that he opens up your scriptures and shares those words with us today, that we continue to say, Holy Spirit, you are welcome here, that through the hearing of your word, we'd be changed and made new. Father, we thank you and we love you. In the name of Jesus, we pray these things. Amen. 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 We want to continue on in worship and week in and week out, we talk about generosity being an act of worship, that we bring in our tithes and our offerings as an opportunity to show that we trust God is who he says he is with our finances. And so we invite you that if you have come prepared to give, that on your way out, there are boxes at the wall that you can participate in giving. And we know that there are many of you that give online and just want to continue to say thank you for your generosity and your faithfulness to be able to use those resources for kingdom impact in this community and across the world. Along with that, we wanted to give you an update. This last month, we talked about the backpack and snack program that we did a little year-end campaign to be able to give towards that program. It is run by the Valparaiso Community Schools, where we have over 350 students that don't have access to food over breaks or over weekends or holidays that the school has stepped in to create this program that is 100% community sponsored to be able to provide those quick and easy meals for those families, those kids, to be able to have access to food over the course of a weekend. And we said we wanted to be part of that. We also said that $9,600 would cover a month of that program to cover all of the students for 1 month. And I wanted to be able to share with you today that we have raised $14,000 and that we are able to cover 6 weeks of that program. So we are so excited. We are celebrating the fact that we are part of a community, part of a tribe, part of a church that has exhibited, again, what it means to be generous, that we can make sure that these kids have access to that food over the course of the weekend. So thank you for your generosity and your faithfulness to make that happen. So we want to continue on in worship. I ask that you would prepare your hearts and prepare your minds to hear this morning's message.
Good morning. Thank you for being with us today. We're starting a new series, Rediscover, as we kind of take a look at revisiting some things maybe that have gotten lost in the shuffle, things about what it means to live a life of following Jesus. It's also 2024. Can you believe it? You made it. Whether that was the goal or not, you made it. Well done. For some of you, a new year means exciting things. It means new opportunities, new ideas, new things that are facing you. For some of you, it fills you with fear and anxiety. Maybe because you're aware of what's coming, or you know what lies ahead, or maybe you know it's coming, you just don't know what it is yet that you are going to have to encounter. For some of you, it's a chance for a restart. It's the opportunity to kind of hit the reset button, to move forward, maybe set some goals, make some changes in your life, some things that you can do, maybe that you want to try and strive for in this new year. For others of you, this may be the start of a new chapter after one of the toughest years of your life. And for some of you, it's another 357 days of knowing you've already failed at all your resolutions and you have to figure out how to live with that. Now, the math may be wrong there, because when I was writing this, I forgot that this was leap year, so it may be off, but if you check in my math as your biggest problem this year, we need to talk, because I need to know what you're doing that I'm not, okay? Regardless of what this year holds for you, one thing is certain. For me, for you, for everybody in this room, we're all going to be faced with decisions. Some of these decisions are going to be smaller, some of them will be bigger, but with that in mind, I want to share a couple verses of scripture with you as we journey together today, and it's not going to be on the screen. I want you to let these words just kind of wash over you and keep them in mind as we go throughout the morning together. Some of you may have these verses memorized, or if not, they're probably at least familiar to you, but Philippians chapter 4, verses 6 and 7 says, "Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus." Now, as I said, some of these decisions that you have this year are going to be small. They're going to be relatively insignificant. Maybe what you have to wear to leave the house in the morning, maybe what you're going to eat for breakfast before you leave, maybe what TV show you're going to watch before you go to bed. Smaller, insignificant decisions really don't require a lot of thought. At least they shouldn't. Other decisions, though, and maybe you're aware of these that are coming, or maybe you're not sure what it is, could be job-related, could be related to relationships, your health, your finances, bigger decisions that are going to require more thought, more time and attention, more energy from you. But we're all going to face choices. So to help you out, here's what we're going to do. We're going to do a few rounds of would you rather, just to kind of get you in the decision-making mode. Now, two rules. Number one, just pick one. Just play the game, okay? Even if you don't like either option, just pick one. Number two, don't overthink this. I'm not trying to add stress to your life. It's just for a little fun, okay? So, first one, would you rather stay up late or go to bed early? Who would rather stay up late? Okay, go to bed early. Okay, about half and half, maybe a few more night owls. All right, next one. Would you rather watch movies or bake cookies? Who are my movie watchers? Okay, well, after you bake them, you can eat them. Bakers, who would rather do something a little bit more productive? Okay, here's the third one. Would you rather drink coffee or drink hot chocolate? Who's my coffee drinkers? Okay, hot chocolate. Okay, now, if you said, go to bed early, watch movies, and drink coffee, you and I should be friends. You are my people. Okay, I got one more for you, and this one's a little bit more involved, maybe. Might require a little bit more thought, but again, just play the game. Don't overthink it. Would you rather relive 2023 or skip straight to 2025 with no idea what's going to happen in 2024? Who wants to relive 23? Okay. Who wants to skip to 25? Okay. First service, I didn't see that coming. I thought about it. I think maybe I understand a little bit more why, but we're not going to get into that. But some of these decisions that we're going to face are going to require a little more thought, right? I mean, drinking coffee or hot chocolate, you knew right away what your answer was. Deciding whether you wanted to repeat or skip ahead, maybe you kind of had to think about that a little more. So for these bigger decisions, as followers of Jesus, how do we make these decisions? What path will we take? Maybe another question is, how do we know that this is God's will for our lives? See, we have tools that we can use, and a lot of times you'll hear us refer to these tools as spiritual disciplines. I mean, things like prayer and fasting and reading scripture and spending time in solitude, all these types of things, different spiritual disciplines, different tools that we have that can help us in making decisions as followers of Jesus. But here's the key. Your heart posture as you do these spiritual disciplines is what's important. It's not just a matter of saying, well, I pray every day and I read my Bible every day, so I'm good. Okay, but if you're just doing it just to be good, that's not helpful. There's a heart posture that's involved. Back in the 1900s, Michelle and I were both seniors in college, and I'll wait. Go ahead. It was 1999, wasn't that long ago. But we were engaged. We were going to get married about a month after we were graduating. And we realized we kind of came to this point where neither one of us had a job. We didn't know where we were going to live. We didn't know how we were going to earn money or, you know, buy food or whatever. We were kind of up against the clock, or at least we felt like we were. We were growing up. And so we needed to make some decisions. And so we needed this job. So we both decided we're just going to send resumes everywhere. And just see what happens. So she started sending resumes to accounting firms kind of all over the country because my wife's a CPA. And I started sending resumes all over to churches and district superintendents. And we just thought, let's just see what happens. So around Christmas, a little bit before Christmas time that year, Michelle gets offered a job at a top five firm in Fort Wayne. Now, when I say top five firm, that just simply referred to there was five CPA firms kind of that were well-known throughout the country. They had multiple locations kind of all over the place. And kind of a big deal to be offered a job from them right out of college with no experience. And so she was offered this job, but the problem was I knew that I was called into full-time ministry, and that was the path for my life. And in fact, when Michelle and I first started dating, about 2 months into our relationship, we went to a restaurant and we sat down and I said, look, this is what God has called me to do with my life, and I need to be obedient to that. And I understand that this is not necessarily for everybody. So if you don't think that you can do this, we need to part ways. Right? No hard feelings, I get it, but we need to know now before we move forward. And we talked about it some more, and she said, I'm in. All right, let's do it. Let's make it happen. So, okay. The problem is a lot of times we don't know what that looks like, right? So Michelle has this job offer in Fort Wayne, but I still don't have a job. Now, in my young and naive mind, I thought there are a lot of Nazarene churches in and around the Fort Wayne area, so surely one of them will hire me to do something, and we'll figure it out from there. Fast forward to March of the year 2000. But let's back up for just a second. At Christmas time, Michelle called Fort Wayne and said, I'm in. We'll be there. We get married this date in June. We'll be there the week after. Takes the job. Fast forward to March. I get a phone call from a church. They want me to come and interview. The church is in Michigan. Now, Fort Wayne's kind of close to Michigan, but it's still more of a commute than what we felt was fair for Michelle to have to make. But we decide we're gonna go to the interview. Problem is, we go through the interview, I get offered the job. Now we have a new dilemma. Michelle's got a job in Fort Wayne, I now have a job in Kalamazoo. What are we gonna do? Because we've heard it's kind of bad to quit a job before you start a job, after you've accepted the job, but we didn't know what to do. So I ended up calling my pastor at the time, and I was like, help. This is new territory for us. We don't know what to do. I mean, I feel like we've both been offered these great opportunities, but obviously we can't make them both work. How do we make this decision? And so he gave me some scripture to read and suggested that maybe we fast and pray. Now, fasting at that time, wasn't a new concept to me, but it wasn't really something that I had ever done. I'd heard of other people that had done it and heard some of their stories and different things like that, but I had never practiced fasting on my own. And in fact, nowhere in the New Testament do we read that followers of Jesus are commanded to fast. In fact, in only one spot in the New Testament do we read that the Jews are commanded to fast, and that is at the Day of Atonement. But we see many examples of those who chose to participate in fasting and prayer and other of these spiritual disciplines, as well as all different types of fasting throughout Scripture. Some of these examples contain fasting certain types of food or maybe all food. Some fasts go so far as to fast all food and water. There's fasts of different types of activities, different things like that. So we see all of these examples. But here's the thing about fasting is that fasting should have a clear purpose. Biblical examples that we see, we read about, show us that there's different reasons for fasting, and typically because somebody wanted something. Maybe it could have been a certain change in their lives from God, or maybe a change in their circumstances, or maybe some type of revelation in their lives. However, it's important to note, fasting is not about manipulating God. No amount of fasting that you or I could do ever could change God's mind or convince him to do something outside of his will. Fasting is about changing ourselves to be in alignment with his will for our life. And see, with fasting, oftentimes the length of time, the length of the fast, and what is being fasted is determined ahead of time. So let me give you an example. We're 7 days into the new year. I've yet to eat spinach. I'm pretty sure I can make it to day 10. But I can't go home today and say, you know what, I think I'm gonna fast spinach for the first 10 days of the year when we're already 7 days in and with no clear purpose as to why. That's not what it's meant to be. And so with our decision with Michelle and I, we decided that we would take 3 days and that each of those 3 days at lunchtime, we would fast and we would pray. She would go to her apartment, and I would go to my apartment on campus, and we would go at lunchtime, and we would spend time alone with God, seeking his will and his direction. And I think we chose lunchtime just because we knew that our roommates would all be gone at lunch, and it would be just a time that we could be alone with God. This was a big decision. We knew it was going to impact our lives moving forward, and for Michelle to quit a job before she even started, it wasn't a good look for her career-wise. So we needed to seek God's face and direction in making this decision. We wanted to make sure that we were doing what it was that God had called us to do. So after 3 days, we still had no clear direction. But here's what we did have. We had a peace about taking the next step and trusting that God would be in all the details. And the peace that passes all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. So we decided that I would take the job in Michigan and Kalamazoo, and Michelle would basically quit her job in Fort Wayne before she started. And when Michelle called to decline the job, she was told that she was never going to get another offer from a top five firm again throughout her career. That these types of decisions, they would follow her. Those people talk, and this is never going to happen for you. We had to make our peace with that. And that was a big sacrifice that I asked her to make. But we were trusting God in the details. Now, also during this process, we did other things like reading scripture, and we sought counsel from others. We spent time in prayer, both together and apart, and we see examples of all of these things throughout scripture. When it comes to the importance of scripture, here's what the Bible has to say about it. 2 Timothy chapter 3, verse 16. All scripture is breathed out by God and profitable for teaching, for reproof, for correction, and for training in righteousness. Romans 10, verse 17 says, so faith comes from hearing, and hearing through the word of Christ. Proverbs 30, verse 5 says, every word of God proves true. He is a shield to those who take refuge in him. And I want to pause here for just a second and stress the importance of being in God's word. This morning, during first service, we had 36 people gathered in the youth center that have decided to go on a journey of reading through the Bible in a year. That group of people are going to journey together, and they're going to have accountability, and they're going to be able to help each other out. They're going to be able to encourage each other. That's called the Bible recap. And if you feel like this is something maybe you need in your life, maybe this is one of those things that as we go into a new year, you're like, you know, I've never done anything like that before, but maybe with a group of people, maybe some encouragement, some accountability, I could make it. It's not too late. We can get you connected. We can help you make that decision. Let us know. But we do that because we believe that being in the Word is critical. It is imperative to better knowing and understanding God's will for our lives. We see several passages in Proverbs that deal with the importance of seeking wise counsel. Proverbs 12:15 says, the way of a fool is right in his own eyes, but a wise man is he who listens to counsel. Just a few chapters later in chapter 15, verse 22, it says, without consultation, plans are frustrated, but with many counselors, they succeed. You also hear us talk a lot about the importance of prayer. It's a part of our weekly worship services. We have a prayer chain here at VNC. We're getting ready to kick off 21 days of prayer in just about a week. Prayer is how we talk to the Father. It's an open line of communication for us. In Scripture, we see so many who sought the Lord through prayer. We see examples of people like Hannah, who eventually becomes the mother of Samuel, but she prayed earnestly for a child. We see examples like Daniel, who interceded for others through prayer and fasting. King David prayed in nearly every situation that he found himself in. Job prayed for his family in the midst of trial and suffering. And then there's Jesus. He taught about prayer. He modeled prayer. He spent much time on his own in prayer, praying for his disciples, praying for the other believers. And see, it's oftentimes through prayer that God will reveal to us the wisdom we need to deal with the situations that we face. Let me say that again. Oftentimes through prayer is when God will reveal to us the wisdom we need to deal with the situations we face. Let's go back to the verse in Philippians that we read earlier. Chapter 4, verses 6 and 7. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. And the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. See, just looking at the very first phrase of that verse, do not be anxious about anything. I don't know about you, my experience, that's a lot easier said than done. I struggle with that. And the kicker is that when Paul's writing these words, he's writing them in prison. I mean, if there's ever a time to be anxious, I would think that's it. But he says, do not be anxious about anything. And these big decisions that we face, they can create anxiety. They can create fear. This decision that Michelle and I had, we were anxious. We were scared out of our minds. Was this the right decision? Were we doing the right thing? Was this going to end poorly? Let me tell you how our story turned out. Before I do, you need to understand that your story is unique to you and your journey with Jesus. It may turn out different than mine did, but that's okay. Because if you're seeking God, he's going to walk with you. So in June of 2000, we moved to Kalamazoo. Michelle found a job at a little CPA firm there in town. And about 3 years later, we moved to Howell, Michigan, where I joined the staff at the church there. And while we were there, Michelle was able to find a job with a bigger firm that was located in East Lansing, which was about a 30-minute drive from where we lived. And not long after that, we found ourselves moving again. This time we were in Council Bluffs, Iowa, which is right on the state line of Iowa and Nebraska. But Michelle, because of the firm that she worked with in East Lansing, they had an office in Omaha. And so she was able just to transfer within the same firm. And it was while she was at work one day there in Omaha, through some conversation with colleagues of her, it was mentioned that the firm that Michelle was working for in Omaha had actually bought the firm that she had quit in Fort Wayne 6 years prior. Now remember, she was told that decision was going to follow her. And when she applied the second time, however, she applied with her married name and not her maiden name, so nobody caught it. Now, we weren't doing this to be deceptive. It was just the timing of how everything played out. I kind of feel like maybe that was part of God's timing. You know, we sang a song earlier, even when I don't see it, you're working. Even when I can't feel it, you're working. I'm convinced God was working. When Michelle made that phone call to Fort Wayne, I said, I'm sorry to do this, but I can't come and work for you. I believe God was in that. Here's my point. For this decision, could have gone one of two ways. We could have ignored everything we had been taught as kids, growing up in the church, being followers of Jesus, and decided we're just going to make this decision on our own. Because we have an idea of how we want it to play out, so it's just easier to do that. I don't know how that would have turned out. Maybe it would have been okay. Maybe it would have been a complete disaster. We'll never know. But by choosing to allow God to have control of the situation, we can look back over our 23 plus years of marriage and see God's hand at work time and time again. Like the time that, if it were up to me, about 4.5 years into ministry, I would have just left the ministry altogether because it was a particularly rough season of ministry for me. But because we sought God together through that, we were able to trust in his plan, which has led us to today. Or like all the times that God provided a job for Michelle in just the right moments every time we relocated. Or like the time when finances were so tight that we often wondered how everything would work out, how the bills would get paid, only to have generous people, many of whom we still have no idea to this day who they were, practice generosity. And they listened to God and provided for us out of their excess at just the right time. Or like the time when we moved to this place called Valparaiso, Indiana, when our children were 2 and 4, and God blessed us with a church family and a church community that has embraced us and loved us so unconditionally that my kids started and ended their schooling in one school system. Because I'm going to be honest with you, the 7 years prior in ministry coming to this place, if you'd have told me that was going to happen, I'd have told you were crazy. I knew too many guys that their tenure at churches was 18 to 24 months, maybe 36 if they were lucky. And it was important for both Michelle and I that our kids would be able to have that experience, that they would be able to have that consistency. And when some of these decisions were made throughout our past 23 years, we didn't know God was working, or we couldn't feel it, but we knew he was there. We couldn't see him, but we knew he was there. I could go on and on and on, listing example after example of how God has been faithful. But the more that we recognize God in the midst of our decisions, even if we don't see him in the moment, and we can look back, a lot of these things, I can look back and see how God was faithful. But when we recognize that, what happens is my relationship with him grows, and I can trust him to take the next step because he's proven faithful. And then when I take the next step and he proves faithful again, guess what? Now I can take the next step. And just because he doesn't lay out the whole plan for me to see, which, to be honest, I would prefer, doesn't mean that I stop trusting. It doesn't mean that we stop trusting. Now, hear me. At times, the journey's been hard. But the joy that comes from knowing that God was in it from the beginning, I wouldn't trade that for anything. And the peace that passes all understanding will guard our hearts and our minds in Christ Jesus. This is what Michelle and I were experiencing. It's what we've been experiencing. So we come back to the decisions that you'll face this year. Some of them are going to be small, relatively insignificant. Some of them are going to be big. Some of them maybe you're aware of, and you're dreading having to make that decision. Some of them, you can't see it coming. You don't know when it's gonna happen. But here's the thing about God. He cares about every single one, big and small. And he wants to walk you through them step by step, moment by moment, day by day. As followers of Jesus, as disciples of Jesus, we are called to lay down our lives daily. We're called to pick up our cross, and we're called to follow him. And a big part of this is seeking God in all things and then being obedient to his leading, whether it's your first choice or your last, whether it's comfortable or uncomfortable, whether it's convenient or it takes you in a completely different direction than you thought you'd go. It may lead to reprioritizing some things in your life to make room for what it is that God wants you to do. It won't always be easy. There's going to be bumps. You may even have some battle scars to show for it on the other side. But hear me when I say this. The cost of following Jesus isn't as cheap as maybe we've made it out to be sometimes. Cost of following Jesus isn't as cheap as maybe as we've made it out to be at times. So here's the question for today. Have you already been faced with some of these decisions in these early days of a new year? Or are you just sailing along waiting for the other shoe to drop, knowing that big decision is just around the corner? And if that's where you're at, what are you doing to prepare yourself for when that time comes? What are you allowing God to do in your life to prepare you for when that big decision stares you down the face? Can I tell you that God wants to walk with you, talk with you through these moments? You don't have to do it alone. You don't have to have all the answers. All you need is just a little faith to be obedient, to take that first step. And then watch what God does and where he leads. So will you make room for him? Will you allow him to do what it is that he wants to do in your life? Will you trust him? See, music has always been a big deal for me. And a lot of times I'll go back and I'll look at lyrics of songs and just read them rather than sing them and allow those thoughts that come to mind, ways in which I can recognize and see how God has been active and faithful in my life. And I love how the team set us up so perfectly this morning, because we sang songs about Christ being our foundation, our cornerstone. In Christ alone, my hope is found. We sang songs about how we want to be in the midst of God's will. We want to be in his presence. We invite him in. We sang songs about who God is. He's a way maker. He's a miracle worker. He's a promise keeper. He's a light in our darkness. And I love that. So will you trust him? Will you make room for him? Will you make the decision to allow God to be in the middle of those decisions that you make, potentially setting yourself up for the best year you've ever had? Will you stand and pray with me this morning? Heavenly Father, we want to trust you. We want to make room for you. We want to allow you to lead and to guide in our lives. And God, when it comes right down to it, I think for a lot of us, the ease in which we're able to do that is dependent on the weight of the decision. And it would seem to make sense that the bigger the decision, the more we would rely on you. But for a lot of us, the truth is that the bigger the decision, we don't want to let go. We want to make it ourselves. We want to try and control everything and map it all out. But as your followers, as your disciples, you call on us to trust you, to live with you, to allow you to lead us and to guide us. So, Father, in these early days of a new year, would you help us? Would you give us the strength to set aside our own wants and our own desires and to make room for you and for your leading in our lives? And well, for this, we'll give you praise. In Jesus' name, amen.
To do whatever you want to.
you trust him today? Will you, as you look ahead towards this next year, will you make room? Even if it's just enough room for that first step. And then be mindful and seek where God is working in your life and celebrate that. Share that with the people around you. Use that as your relationship with Jesus begins to grow and continues to grow, to take that next step and that next step. Thank you so much for being here to worship with us today. Again, just a reminder, if you are relatively new and you have not had a chance to join us for this yet, Lunch with Leaders is going to be over here in the Youth Center. To my left, your right, it's a free meal. Come and join us. Hang out with us for a bit. Go in the peace and joy of the Lord. You are free to go. We'll see you next week.